Hey everybody, stay tuned where Christian and I will be talking about enterprise landing zones and digging really deep into how you can implement them in your environment. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show. We are talking with Microsoft experts to try and uncover some of the questions or obstacles you might face when you're on a cloud adoption journey. Now, we've been talking about Azure landing zones and how to choose the right Azure landing zone for your environment. And today, to take a deep dive into enterprise scale landing zones, is Christian as my guest. Welcome to the show, Christian.
Thank you so much for having me here, Sarah.
Awesome. So in the last episode, Rob kind of demonstrated enterprise scale landing zones to me, but I'm hoping that you're going to do a deep dive and show me a bit more of the architecture and a longer demo. Is that okay, Christian?
That's absolutely spot on in what I'm planning to do here. So that sounds like a good plan.
Cool. So can you take me through some of the different reference implementations that we have and tell me what they're for, please?
Yes, we can definitely, that's actually what I want to spend time on, to, you know, build on what Rob started when he had his 15 minutes of fame or so. We're going to take that, we're going to dive deeper into that and actually explore, you know, what's the composition like in the enterprise scale context, right? How do we actually identify and realize some of the design principles that we have, and how do we make it more real? So I've actually prepared a set of decks and I want to spend some time here to just talk a bit about them. And then we're actually going to look at some visuals in the deck itself to get an understanding of how does all of this come together for a given scenario and things like that. And then, of course, we're going to do some hands-on keyboard demonstrations and show you that as well.
Awesome.
So I think let's start. Rob, he shared likely the deployment experience of the reference implementation. And the fact is that we have three different reference implementations today that all share the same experience in terms of what you can achieve as part of that bootstrapping process. All of them are self-service, one-click deployment experience in the Azure portal backed by Azure Resource Manager templates. And what's interesting when you kind of dive a bit deeper into them, and as Rob talked about as well, is that in the cloud adoption framework, we have the enterprise scale architecture and the design methodology. And if you open up and see there, we have actually five design principles, such as the single controller management plane, we have subscription democratization, policy-driven governance, archetype neutral migration, as well as Azure native services aligned to the Azure roadmap. So all of this basically is coming together as you deploy the enterprise scale reference implementation. And another thing that I also personally think is great is that many ask us, hey, is this just a greenfield, right? Because we know that the reality is that there is very likely there's some existing resources in that Azure tenant from before. And yes, this can be deployed both into a brownfield Azure AD tenant as well as a greenfield. But what I specifically want to talk about is the modularity piece of it, okay? So mm-hmm. We have three reference implementation. We have the one we have categorized as Contoso, which is using virtual WAN as the hybrid connectivity and networking topology for the entire Azure platform. The other option we have, which is kind of similar, is the Adventure Works. However, there the approach is to use a more traditional hub and spoke approach to solve for that hybrid connectivity scenarios. And then we basically have the Wingtip that is the reference implementation for customers who just want to get started in Azure. They don't have a specific requirement for hybrid connectivity on the get-go, and they just want to move on. Does that make sense so far, Sarah?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One thing I wanted to ask you was, those reference implementations, are they just for, brand new customers to Azure that aren't maybe attempting to connect their on-prem environments up into the cloud as well? Is that the right way to look at those ones you've just taken us through?
No, absolutely. This is reference implementation regardless of where the customer is on their journey, right? So they can, you know, have an existing footprint, as I said, and then, you know, there might be different reasons. Perhaps they have reached a limit, they need to refactor and do any things. And this is the architecture that allows those customers to get on that, we often refer to as into the pit of success, where they can have that sustainable architecture, regardless of their scenarios and scale points for their workloads as well.
Awesome. So I am hoping you have a reference implementation for customers who want to connect their on-prem environment up into the cloud. Is that what you're going to show me next, Christian?
Well, actually, before that, we're going to look at the modularity. But to okay. your point, we do have both Contoso and AdventureWorks definitely cater for those scenarios where you have that on-prem environment you're going to bring into the cloud where you would need that hybrid connectivity. It's just slightly different implementation in terms of using the new virtual VAN and also the more traditional virtual network through a hub and spoke model. But let's have a look and see how we're thinking about this from a modularity and architecture perspective. Mm-hmm. So assuming that from this deck, what we try to illustrate here is how does the enterprise scale reference implementation look like from a workload dial perspective, right? So the thought process here is that you, in this scenario, you do not have the need for hybrid connectivity immediately, right? So you can start up using that wingtip reference implementation. And as you can see on this slide, we have approximately 50 workloads, right? And those 50 workloads, they go into the landing zone. And the landing zone here is represented by a subscription rooted into the online management group inside the landing zone management group. On the left-hand side, though, you can see there's also a management subscription. This management subscription is inside the management group located in the platform management group. And this is a key thing I just want to double click on why this is such an important thing. Because already here from the get-go, we have done a very important thing, and that is really separating the platform and what's identified as being the workloads. Okay? So this means that as we're gonna, you know, turn the dial a bit, you can see how do we think about scale from this perspective, right? So already here you have that clean path where you can transition into whatever next is coming. So now I just want to turn the dial and see what that looks like. So we're going to turn it to 100 workloads. And now you can see the actual thing we had to introduce here, and whether this is because, you know, running into some of the subscription limits we may have in Azure, resource-specific limits, or there is a new application team coming in and you want to have a clear separation of duties, we introduce another subscription into the landing zone so that workload can continue to be deployed and moved into Azure. And again, you can see the architecture basically remains the same. We have that separated platform side. We now also have N number of workloads in N number of landing zones as well. So what do you say, Sarah? Should we turn it out further?
Yep, go back.
Yeah, go for it. So another common question is, okay, this is great. Now we have, previously we had two landing zones, right? And they all, workloads landed there. They shared basically some common characteristics given that they were all put inside the online management group. Now, as new requirements comes along, in this case, there is a special workload requiring other, aspects in terms of governance, compliance, and things like that. So we need a way to place our PCI compliant workload as well. So what we're doing here is that we're introducing that PCI workload management group under the landing zone management group so that those workloads with those requirements, they can actually land there. And the benefit here is that now we have actually an architecture and a platform that allows for N number of landing zones into the online management group. We also have a designated home for N number of workloads that needs to be PCI compliant as well. So what do you think, Sarah, if we go to the extreme and just look at this from a 10,000 workload perspective?
Oh, yeah. Let's turn that dial, Christian.
Let's turn the dial. And what you can see here, I know this is, you're starting to look at things and it looks like you perhaps a bit more complex, right? But there's a couple of things that's going on here. One, you can see on the platform side now as well, there are some changes, right? We have the management subscription, which is the subscription intending to cater for all the auditing, security, and logging for the entire platform. But now we have also a connectivity subscription, right? To your question earlier, how, you know, when we're going to migrate from on-premises to Azure, what do we need, right? And this is where we had that dedicated subscription for that global connectivity aspect of it. We also have introduced an identity subscription to handle for the authentication scenarios inside the landing zones themselves. And as you can see now, we also have a management group in the landing zone identified as Corp. So those are the workload that requires that on-prem connectivity dialing back home for those migration scenarios. But the beauty here is that both on the platform side, as well as the landing zone side, you can now scale those independently without impacting each other and also not impacting existing resources already deployed into Azure. And there's a couple of other things here that's, you know, it's not crystal clear just looking at this deck. But one of the principles we have in enterprise scale is this policy-driven governance. Because a typical question we would likely get by going through this is, okay, with so many subscriptions, there has to be a management overhead, right? There is a burden, right? We cannot do this. But with policy-driven governance, what that means from our perspective, as well as what the platform provides, means that no matter how these resources are being created, and remember, even a subscription is a resource in this context, right? Doesn't matter how it's created, when it's dropped into the designated management group, policy will apply and bring all those resources to its goal state. So there's no need, if you take that approach, to actually have someone to sit and do XYZ activities to make that subscription ready for the application teams. So the policy actually enables the autonomy for both the platform side as well as the landing zone side. And again, regardless of scale point.
Excellent. That sounds fantastic. And I do love a good architectural diagram. But I'm hoping you're going to be able to do some hands-on keyboard and show us in action rather than just in a diagram, Christian. Is that okay?
That's absolutely okay. And that's exactly what I'm planning to do right now. So let's move over to the environment. And looking at what Rob started, in his session, we now have deployed enterprise scale. We have the management group hierarchy, the one I talked about. Specifically inside the landing zones, we have the one subscription in my environment because we just got this started, right? But as I add more subscriptions into here, they will all be subject to the different controls that we have applied using a policy-driven governance. So one thing I just want to show is that when this subscription lands inside this management group, we can actually go and take a look at some of the policies that are applied for the specific workloads that will land into the landing zone itself. So if I look at the compliance here and I drill a bit down, and again, this is a demo environment, so there's a lot of stuff in flight here. But if I go into a particular policy that says, deploy AAC. Okay, if I open that up and actually look at it, you can see that in the compliance result from this policy, we have a resource here that is compliant. And if we expand a bit on the resource type, you can see that, hey, this is actually a subscription, right? And what this means is that this subscription is compliant because as part of that placement of the subscription, Azure Security Center gets enabled. So we can actually just quickly explore the policy itself that does that magic. And what we're going to look at here is that we have a policy rule. It will look for the subscriptions, if there is a type subscription, and then it will check on a couple of resources. And if these resources are not there, it will deploy them using deploy if not exist effect. So this will then start an ARM template that goes and target that subscription and goes and enable Security Center. Okay, sounds fantastic, right?
Yeah, so
if I now navigate to Security Center inside the environment that I have provisioned here, you can see that basically all the subscriptions that I have, the platform, the management, the connectivity, but also the landing zone, they're all good. They're secure, they're compliant from the get-go. Okay, so this is basically the platform side, what this means, having this autonomy enabled. What I also want to just spend some time on is, okay, what does this mean for the actual application team that are gonna deploy their workloads, okay? So we're gonna put on the workload lenses, and now I'm inside one of the landing zone subscription, and here you can see I have deployed stuff and I've done certain activities, right? Because I'm building stuff. And if we're going to look at the one of the application, we have HR application 01. If I look into that, actually, when I started deploying into here, I actually went to the Azure Marketplace, right? I needed a Windows Server 2016, and then I also needed Key Vault, right? Because that's where I started, and later on, I added more resources as well. Some resources were added using PowerShell, some using CLI, and even Terraform, okay?
Okay.
So what happened then, if we go, you can see there's quite a few deployments inside this resource group. So if I scroll down to see the first thing I did, I went to the marketplace and I deployed the Windows Server. I also went to create the Key Vault. And from there and onwards, you can see there's actually quite a few policy deployments happening here, right? And then I added another machine and you can see additional policy deployments.
Excellent.
Should we have a look and see what actually happens?
Oh, please do. Yeah, please dive in deeper.
So let's go into the overview again, and let's look at this from a VM perspective in this case. So what happens when we deploy this one is that policy applied to the landing zone ensures that virtual machines, web apps, SQL, whatnot, they're all brought through their goal state. So what that means from this particular resource is that if I now go and look at backup, I should now see that this VM is already protected into an Azure backup vault that also got created as part of the policy, right? So as an application owner, I didn't have to think about that. I didn't have to ensure that backup was part of my VM when I created it because policy came in and brought it to its goal state. And similarly, if I now want to patch my VM as an application owner, I can do that as well. It's already wired up. It's connected to Loganalytics. It has the Azure Automation account there to actually help me to do the patching that I need to keep my machines healthy. And similar for the inventory and all the other things, you can see that we have that prepared. It's already monitored. We can see the inventory of the machine. We can see, what's the connectivity landscape? Who is it talking to? We can see the performance. So it's already there by default as part of landing into this landing zone. And the last piece I want to show you here, Sarah, is that if I zoom out again to the resource group, and I just want to look at the diagnostic settings, we can also see that for all the non-compute resources, such as a Key Vault, the network interface, you can see the diagnostics is enabled for them all, right? So if I just look at the Key Vault, you can see that it already has the diagnostic settings and it's already reporting to the designated Loganalytics workspace that is located in the management subscription on the platform side. So this enabled that at scale horizontal view from a platform perspective, but it also gives the individual application team the benefit of consuming the same quality services from the same resources.
Awesome. I can totally see how you've taken the diagrams you've shown us and actually implemented them in Azure, and also the benefits of actually using these enterprise scale landing zones. So thank you so much for your time, Christian. You've definitely sold me on using the enterprise scale landing zone for my environment. Now, if you're looking to use enterprise scale landing zones in your environment, please do check out our description box where we'll be putting some links to further resources. And please do tune in for further episodes of the Azure Enablement Show.